Welcome everybody to this session. My name is Dakshinamurthy, and next 45 minutes or so I'll be talking about understanding language. So I changed the title from what is mentioned in the brochure. Just this was cuter, and I felt it was deeper. So but the idea is how do machines understand language, and how do we benefit from understanding how they are understanding the language. Post lunch talks are always tricky. I'll try to keep you all up and running for the next 45 minutes, so I'll do my best. Right. One slide about the organization that I represent. I am from International School of Engineering. We are the AI Machine Learning Research and Education Institution. We are present in India, in Hyderabad, Bangalore, and Mumbai. We have academic partners in France, Rennes School of Business, in USA, Case Western Reserve University, and in Canada, Carleton University. 60 plus faculty and scientists, all are interested in AI ML, working on that. Two products are already launched. Two products are in the pipeline, 75 plus patents, 1,000 publications. So we are very actively involved in research. Faculty either research on technology areas like blockchain, big data, IoT, on analytics, or applications of analytics in healthcare, financial markets, etc. So we teach and we do research. So that's what we do. In that institute, I am one of the investigators for the AI for Business group. So the theme of our research is, we are not that keen on inventing new models. What we acknowledge is that really smart people are creating really smart models, and really fast. Every day there is a new model. And most of these models are very academic, in the sense that because it's developed in a university setting, the accuracy, the performance is given a lot of importance. But when business wants to apply, really accuracy is only one of the indicators. You have to look at its productionizability, its maintainability, the stability, a bunch of things come into picture. So they need separate metrics and frameworks. Our group tries to create those metrics and frameworks and facilitate that process. So today, while we look at a bunch of AI machine learning related models, today I want to focus on natural language processing. And why is that? I started seriously looking at NLP in 2010-2011. At that time, the state of the art models were conditional random fields. Super cool mathematics. I mean, log linear models, stochastic gradient descent, and it allowed domain experts to input their features in a very cool and smart way, sort of machine learning at its best. You needed domain experts, you needed super tough math, ideal setting for a PhD to feel good about. And I thought, I can apply it. I did a few use cases, and I told myself, I will live happily ever after. Only then, one of my clients called and said, two interns we hired for my undergrad institute built something called an LSTM that broke whatever you did for 6 months, man. They just gave more data, no features, nothing. Oh, okay. Ego got crushed. For a long time, I used to call these Starbuck neural networks, Large, short, tall, medium neural networks, whatever you do, I was upset, obviously. But then, I got to live with that. And I said, okay, I broke up with CRF, started dating LSTMs, said, oh, they're super cool. So, they can do all that. And by 2013, 2014, I said, yeah, LSTMs, I think I can apply. I know how to do this. And then I saw Google doing something odd. One day I saw a paper where they said my LSTM is one part of one half of it. They said, there is an LSTM, then we'll run another LSTM in the reverse direction, and then we will stack 8 of them one on top of each other and provide a residual connection. This is one half. We call it encoder. And then we have those 8 layers on the other side, we call it decoder, and we'll put something in between, we call it attention. What is happening here? Okay? I said, okay, what do I do? And it took me some more time to figure out. And then when I thought, okay, I partly understood it, last 12 months, they said Bert, they said ExcelNet, they said Ernie. I mean, where am I going here? So I said, wait. I can't be spending my life fine-tuning hyperparameters of these models. I have to understand something more about how these guys do these cool things. Okay? So whenever you want to understand something much deeper, it probably benefits to ask very simple questions. So I asked myself, how do we humans understand language? Okay, is there anything that I can correlate it to the way these models understand the language? So tried observing a few kids actually and started taking notes. First thing, when you're learning a language, you learn a few words. And you start guessing the meaning of the sentence with that one word or two words that you know. Okay, so that's, you know, if you were to pick a completely new language, probably that's what you do. And once we get there, once we understand, we start forming some naive rules, you know. If there is a dollar, most likely it's currency. If there are 10 numbers, probably it's a mobile phone. Number. So we sort of make up these simple rules, and probably after some time we build fairly complex parsing, we split it into multiple things, combine and start understanding the language. And then once we become comfortable with the language, we start guessing trends. We build beautiful autoregression. So the clouds are in the dash. You and I probably will tell skies. And someone in the IT department will say server room, whatever that is. Okay, they are somewhere. We start filling in the gaps, learning these autoregressions, trends. That's another very important step. And lastly, we seem to be becoming good with what we learned. We don't forget for the next task what we learned in the previous task. We sort of build it. So these are the paradigms or dimensions in which humans learn languages. And what I found interesting was that whether thinking about it explicitly or not, the machine learning community actually went about in more or less the same way to solve the natural language problem. And let's see how. First thing, learning words. The naivest thing was the one hot vector. When people in 1950s and 60s, the machine learning community might have influenced them. You know, whenever you see a categorical attribute, just dummify it, right? So whenever you see a word, depending on the vocabulary size, if your vocabulary is 10,000 words, you create a 10,000 dimension vector. And put your words in alphabetical order. And the first word is 10000, second one is 01000, and so on and so forth. So a vector of V dimension, where V is the dimension of the vocabulary, where V minus 1 zeros and just one hot guy. So there is only one hanging around there. So that's one hot vector. But the problem is book, library, cricket, any topic, 10000, 10000, 01000, they are all similar to each other, equidistant, because they are all just one and several zeros, right? Euclidean distance is always root 2. So they didn't have even the basic semantics needed to understand the language. So while this is a representation we invented, I don't think it's relevant for any major problem, right, to solve it. I'm going to plot models in a specific graph. Let me spend a minute on the strategy that I adopted. I should work with some visualization experts to come up with something better, but this is what I have currently. The x-axis, I'm going to just write the models in chronological order to the extent possible. I'm not an AI historian, so if I miss a year or two, don't worry. But in general, the chronological order. Y-axis is going to be the model's ability to understand the words. So one hot vector doesn't understand word meanings. It's a very dumb representation, right? So it's at zero. So there's no understanding of the words. Now, the color is how well it does the trend prediction. So how well it looks at past words and guesses future words. there is no color here, so it doesn't do anything. The shape, number of sides in the thing, I want to represent by how well it parses and applies the rules. Okay, this is again a circle with no shape, so there's no parsing, no rules, nothing. And overall size is the performance of the model. I could have drawn smaller thing, but I was worried whether it will become visible or not. But this is almost a point. So this is sort of nowhere, you know. So I'm going to, as we discuss more and more models, I'll fill this graph, right? Okay, that's where one hot vectors are. Then in 1960s, a bunch of machine learning guys made some really smart hypothesis about understanding words. They said, hey, those words that occur in few documents, but when they occur, that occur in large frequency are really useful words. Because if they are all over the place, they must be a the or than space filler. But if they are in a document but only once, maybe it's just a fluke. But in a few documents, but when they occur, if they occur a lot of times, then it must be a really useful word. So they created what you probably know, definitely know, are these term document matrices, where they took a lot of documents and put them in columns, lot of terms and put them in rows. And at base level, you binary, if the term is present in that document 1, else 0. Or if you want to scale it by the number of times it occurred across the documents and within the document, you can come up with some nice smart scaling factors, and they will become some numbers like this. Okay. Now, this vector of the word understanding is a lot better than the one-hot vector, because most likely similar terms will appear in similar documents. So when the vectors are similar, it means that they occurred in similar documents. So most likely they are very similar to each other. So got better than one-hot vector. But the problem with this model is this is still extremely, it's not as sparse as one-hot, but very sparse, right? There are only a few numbers. More importantly, this is much larger dimensions. I mean, if you think of a Google, this is a billion documents. So your one-hot vector is probably size of the vocabulary. This is size of the corpus. So this is scary. So what people did is, hey, you know what? This number here is a combination of two things. It's there because the document wants to express some concepts, and the term is capable of expressing those concepts. Only when there is a match between the concepts that the document is wanting to express and the concepts that the term is willing to, or is capable of expressing, you see that term in that document. So they believe this matrix is because of two submatrices. One is a term and its concepts. Another one is a document and the concepts that it wants to express. So they created linear algebra guys went ahead and did some really cool things, figured out a way to split this matrix into these two matrices, term concept and concept document. And what is the advantage? This can be a very small number. This can be 100,000 by million, but this can be 100,000 by 300 or 200. This can be 200 by million. So your matrix overall will form again. So the term concept vectors are much shorter, number one, and much more denser. So that itself is an advantage. But really what clinched the deal here is the term documents are very document specific. So if there is a document on data science and it doesn't have the word AI, I will get a zero there. But term concept, on the other hand, when you factorize it, it figures out that, you know, AI and data science occurred in many other documents together. So probably they are similar concepts. So even though at this point in this document AI is not there, most likely they are relevant words. So it figures that out. So long range interactions, short dimension, and sparse sort of clinched. So they are very, very popular. I think in 1990s, these were quite popular. Now, okay, I understood the words well. That's only one part, right? What else can I do? Can I parse? Can I build trends? Can I build rules? These models have inherent problem with building trends, simply because I dropped many words that I thought are unnecessary. So previous two words, concept is not there. I lost the order of the words. I put them in alphabetical order. I am gone for good. So the only thing that they could try was building rules. And regular expressions was one way where a human was giving those heuristics. I don't even think we can call it machine learning, right? You give rules, it's not machine learning. So the more popular method is you take these term concept or term document matrices, they are structured data, so you apply your logistic regression or support vector machine to build the rules on top of that. So this is the second generation. Can we take questions after the talk? Oh, no, this is SVD kind of matrix factorization, term concept. Right, TF-IDF is the original one, term BO double, bag of words thing. Okay, so do ML on it, you find these simple rules. So in my graph now, these guys still don't have any trends and hence I haven't colored them. A few rules that they identified through ML, so I made the shape a bit more complicated. So the number of sides is a sort of indication of whether what they're doing. So they are better than one heart in terms of word understanding. And they are better than one heart in terms of the fact that they are combining word understanding with rules. Still, they are not very much there with respect to rules. That's okay. So in word understanding, as you guys probably know, the ultimate happened in 2013, right? Word embeddings, king minus man plus woman is queen, oh, all that. Google actually is very good at marketing some of these things. I mean, there was enough work even before that, but somehow Google just became so prominent with it. But by the way, last year someone really studied this and they found that Word2Vec did something crazy. I mean, when you ask if father is a doctor, what is mother? It said nurse. That's a different discussion altogether. But you know what? Yeah, it became sexist without realizing. But anyway, let's not get into that. But Glove and Word2Vec sort of opened a new era. Glove went with these co-occurrence matrices. They took a vocabulary by vocabulary matrix. And they saw every word, what precedes it, what succeeds it, what is two words away, what is two words this way, and came up with probability distributions of the words and then factorized it. That was Glove. Word2Vec, on the other hand, is a brute force neural network. You give one heart vector here, you predict the next word, and somewhere in the middle, neural net keeps creating better and better representations, right? So you pick the representation that you want. So Word2Vec is extremely popular. But Word2Vec and Glove have this problem. In the era of Twitter, even if I start with a million words, someone else invents a new word. And when there is a new word, my entire Word2Vec, I have to randomly initialize again. So I have to retrain the entire model. So many models came up to solve that problem, Facebook, fast text, etc. My favorite is that Spacey's Bloom is quite good. Essentially what they do is they embed a portion of the word. So Spacey's Bloom takes the prefix, embeds it, suffix, embeds it, and word embeds it. If it's not there, it will give a random thing. And it also creates categories. So if there is a capital letter initially, it calls them init cap. So all words that are started with initial capitalization, they go under that group. All digits, four digits, all caps. Like that, they created some 10,000 groups into which the entire vocabulary. So even if there is a spelling mistake, it forms one of those things. And they embedded the groups also. So the embedding of a word is embedding of prefix, suffix, the word, and the group, and they add them up. So it handles the out of vocabulary and spelling mistakes a lot more elegantly. But Bloom is only one example. Fast text does that. There are many other embeddings that do that. But all these embeddings are context free, which means if I have a sentence like this, he went to a prison cell with a cell phone to extract the DNA cell samples of the inside inmates, all cells will have same embedding, right? Because you get one embedding for one word. So that's the problem. So these are contextless. But still, having said that, this is like a new era and people were super kicked about it. So in terms of understanding words and doing ML on top of that, and people did some really simple things and that worked beautifully. It's like, I saw sentiment analysis paper where they took word vectors of each word, they added all of them, called that sentence word vector, and attach the sentiment and build an SVM on top of that. And it gives state of the art results. I mean, so really understanding words can take you a long way. And this is probably the ultimate of understanding words. Now, parallelly, there is another community that was focusing on understanding language only through regression. I want to fill in the blanks. Given the past two words, how will I guess the next word? So the approach there is, you know, you compute, you look at large corpus and say, what is the probability that I see this word? What is the probability that I see this word given I saw this word? What is the probability that I see this word given I saw these two words? And so learn all these unigram, bigram, trigram, as they call them, probabilities, and then use Bayes' theorem to predict what is the next word. For some time, Google, you feel lucky, was using something like that. Okay, probably now they use neural nets. I really don't know what technology they use. But this was a workhorse. This Markovian model was the workhorse of regression-based language models from 1980s to 2000 also. Okay. And the culmination of that is these hidden Markov models, which are really smart. It's so sad that they lose to neural nets, actually. And this is like so nicely mathematically developed, you know. They use Bayes' theorem. So a word and its part of speech. What is the joint probability? They use Bayes' theorem. And then they use Markov model on the, so I see the words, but I don't see the parts of speech. So the Markov model is now on the part of speech. What is the probability that it's a noun, given that the previous one is a verb and given that the previous one is a determiner? So the Markov model is not built on the word here, but on the hidden state of the word. So there is a Bayes theorem to do joint distribution. There's a Markov model. Now, one word, let's say there are three possible states. It could be a noun, verb, or determiner with very close probabilities. Now I have a sentence with 10 words. And 10 possible parts of each one is top three guys, if I put. That is a 3 to the power of 10 combinations. That's humongous. So they used like really smart dynamic programming kind of counting to actually solve that problem. So hidden Markov models are mathematically extremely elegant. But anyway, I can get romantic about it, but they are dead. Okay, well, more or less, right? So, but. That was very, very popular, 1980s to 2000. This is a parallel track to NLP, where you are only looking at regression to solve the NLP problem. Previously, all the models were only looking at meaning of the word. So I sort of cheated, squeezed it in. Now, again, I'm not an AI historian, so this came first or this came first, I really don't know. I just had to put it somewhere. So around this time, they came first. There's no word meaning, so I brought it down, and there are no rules other than the regression, so there is no shape or anything. But I colored it because trending is beginning to be learned. Trend we decided to indicate with color. So this is like sort of, it tells you there is regression in it, but no word understanding and no rules in it. Good. 2002, 2003, and then came these conditional random fields. Did any of you study it anywhere? Oh my goodness. Oh, this was ultimate in machine learning at some point, okay? But anyway, don't worry about it. They lost the war. Okay. But conditional random fields are beautiful because they are the first attempt to combine trending with rules. Two of the four are connected. The machine learning model on term document is meaning with rules, right? This is trending with rules. So it had all the things that a hidden Markov model could do. So what is this probability of this, given the previous one is this, given the previous one is this, it had all that. But it also had a very elegant way for a domain expert to add whatever features he or she thought was important. So let's say statistical model. I want to predict the part of speech of model. I can add a feature like, is model capitalized? Is the prefix of the last word statistical, ICAL? If it's yes or no, and these are normally called indicator function in their language, but you create these hundreds of features. I read somewhere that the state of the art POS at that time had 100,000 features hand coded. I mean, you need a lot of grad students to do that. Yeah, right. 100,000 features hand-coded, and they, you know, they built it. And then it's elegant machine learning, right? You have here 100,000 features. X1, X2 here are not words. They are the features. And you learn from data W1, W2, W3, classic machine learning. And it can be a negative or a positive number. So you do a exponentiate it and softmax it. So that's why they're log linear model. So if this whole sum is minus 100 also, I don't care. E to the power of minus 100 still is a positive number. And when I softmax it, I get a probability. So conditional random fields had this beautiful trending and an elegant framework to fit the rules and super mechanism of gradient descent to solve the problem. Really, they were state of the art. So somewhere around this, there are definitely a lot of trending in it, as good as hidden Markov models. And the rules are many, many more. Hidden Markov only looks at trend. Whereas here, I can add my rules. So I made the shape more complicated. Still, word meanings are not added. So they don't have any bag of word or anything. It's just words are just treated as entities or categorical attributes. Right, so, but performance wise, these are anywhere comparable to these, so they are fine. Then came the era of deep learning. I said deep learning 1.4, nowadays that's the fad. I think you see industry 4.0, web 2.0, so I just thought I would also add a few, but this is like 7 years back, deep learning, right? When you started deep learning, the first efforts in deep learning was about combining meaning and trending. So I have the back, Google word to vec or something. They go in as inputs. Now I build it on top of a LSTM, which can look at much longer trending than HMM. I'm not just looking at two words back, but I can look at much longer sequences. That's why I called it autoregression 4.0, much larger than HMM. So you combined meanings and you combined trend. Hidden Markov model was only doing trend. This is meaning come trend, and trend is much larger. And then they said, hey, you know what? You combine trend from this direction, and then you combine trend from this direction, and you concatenate them. You get trend from both directions. So that is bidirectional LSTM. Even today, most people think of this as the most fundamental unit to learn regression-based patterns in text, right? Bidirectional LSTM. And the meaning is fed from here, and then there is a bidirectional LSTM. But there are quite a few instances, and personally, I also experienced, even convolution neural nets do a very good job of getting the context. LSTMs, the problem is they go too long, right? Is it good to actually have such long trending? Do you want to predict tomorrow's Google price by looking at 15 years back Google price? No, you may not want to, right? So convolution neural nets, on the other hand, are much more closer in terms of looking at the thing. So those three, W1, W2, W3 formed some embedding here. The W2, W2, 3, W4 formed this. W3, W4, W5 formed this. Now these three formed this in a typical convolution neural net, local connection. But if you think now about this thing is not only an embedding for word 3, but also includes the context information of 1, 2 on that side, 4, 5 on this side. So I am getting a short-term bidirectional context inputs into my word embedding. So actually, CNNs work very well in practice in embedding. By the way, people call this encoding. When embedding normally is when you just get that word to vec kind of a meaning. Encoding is when you add context to it. So do a convolution or do an LSTM to actually give it a shade of the past or future words. Okay. So both are fairly popular, though I would say this is probably more known. For some reason, some of the commercial products actually only use this, but they don't publicize it that much. I don't know why. Anyway, then of course, this ELMO is another very popular thing which encoded, where it started with one-hot encoding of characters and used a convolution neural net to create a word-level embedding and then put those words in LSTM to get that encoding, which is context-rich. So a CNN gives a word embedding and the they give a context LSTM gives a context embedding that is very, very powerful. So I am adding meaning and trend in these models. But it's very interesting, they don't deal with an entire word, they will deal with only a small fraction of the word. So even if your vocabulary is 10 million, they are able to divide it into 30,000 fractions. You can combine them in multiple ways to create as many words as you want. So that's also a very powerful representation. So these are state of the art. So in this phase of machine learning, deep learning, we are combining meaning and trend, right? And we almost forgot that last thing that we use, right? Which is we become good with time. Until now, there was no way for us to incorporate that. So in language, this whole transfer learning was a very late entrant. Nobody was transfer learning. But in the past 2 years, this became extremely popular. People use two ways. You know, how do I transfer learn? One is, you know, train on entire Wikipedia a language model. Language model is a very funky way of saying, you know, given the past word, predict the next word. So I don't have to tag it. It's unsupervised, right? If I take entire Wikipedia, I write it as previous word, next word, and I try to predict. And learn all the weights based on English language. Then you take your problem and tweak only the weights a bit. Or there is another technique that people are doing. Build a neural net. Keep most of it common. Only last layers different and learn multiple tasks. Okay? Classification, language model, translation. Sentiment analysis, learn multiple things. So most weights get tweaked and tweaked and tweaked because they are learning multiple tasks on the same data, but they have to learn. Last layers are what? Task specific. Medium, initial layers are all language specific. So people did pre-training. So bidirectional, so trending is covered. Word embeddings, so meaning is covered. Pre-training, training is covered. So 3 out of 4, and we had really powerful models in the horizon. Almost done, if only we can add rules to it. We have to figure out a way to add rules to it. And we didn't know how to. And manually you can, but deep neural nets are not very friendly to manual inputs. So Ashio Bengio came up with attention, rules rigged and parsing perfected. I mean, probably he didn't even realize when he proposed it that he was actually building a parser. He was building it for, at least the paper talks about doing something else. That's also a very tough problem. But attention essentially is a mechanism where, see, until now with my word embedding and context thing, each word is represented as a vector. So in a sentence, let's say I have 4 or 5 words, I'll have 4 rows, 1 row for each word. And I have these vectors. Now, attention essentially is a way to learn for a given task how important are these words. So I learn a weight for each of these words. H here is H1, H2, H3, right? Capital H here. So essentially, I may say, hey, you know what? For this particular, at this particular moment, this word and this word are very important. I can ignore all others. Now, this and this are very important. Now, this, and you use a neural net to learn it. Obviously, you don't write those rules, right? So attention is a very powerful way to learn every vector's importance in a given task. And that involves essentially taking elements from this vector, that vector, combining exactly that parsing and rules that I talked about. So the CRF rules are human generated. So human reads the text, understands the patterns, and writes the rules. Whereas attention rules are much more deepish. Neural net learns those rules because neural net already understands the embeddings that are highly context rich. So attention sort of solved the game. And this person, he's a founder of Spacey, wrote a very influential blog, Embed, Encode, Attend, Predict. This is the blueprint of NLP. It actually fits very well with the framework that I talked about until now. Embed is about understanding words. Encode is about understanding trends. Attend is about understanding rules. What is missing? What is the flaw in this approach, if you can think about? Okay. Only one thing that I said is not part. It's not learning, transfer, no transfer learning in the model. So if only I have to update it, I will say pre-train. Because we said four things are needed for perfect language model, right? This is 2016 and okay, we are 3 years ahead, so we can add this, right? Embed, encode, attend, and predict. It's a very powerful model. Yeah, I think pre-train will really improve the performance even further. How am I doing with time? 10 minutes, okay. I'm almost done, yeah. So in my graph now, I have embed, encode, attend, predict, pre-train at the very end. So it is the perfect in word meaning. It's beautiful and it's thick, black, pitch dark. So it really understands trends extremely well. And I wanted to draw something a more complicated shape, but star, I thought symbolically, it shows it's super cool. So that's why I left it at star. But it can actually do really complex rules and patterns and pre-train. So it learns and it gets better with each thing. If you have time, look at an architecture in 2016-17 called hierarchical neural net, which is actually built on this model. So they take words and build a sentence level vector through embed, encode, and predict. And then they take sentences to create a paragraph level vector through encode, embed, encode, predict. And then they do a document classification task. So very systematically, you just write these models. So I personally believe for many business applications, this probably could be the, you know, could be good enough. I mean, yeah, this has everything in it. So then why BERT? What does BERT do differently? What does ExcelNet do differently? What are they doing? Even I'm also surprised. So yeah, this is where it stands. So it didn't cheat, it played well. But then when BERT came, Google guys more or less said, yeah, you know, this is great. We'll do a bit of training, but you know what? We will brute force parsing and rules. So they created an amazingly complicated shape in my today's this thing, you know. I mean, each time you do six different rule generators acting independently. They called it multi-head attention. So each one builds its own set of rules. They combine all of them, then send it to another six things, then combine all of them. Like that, 12 layers. Oh my goodness, that is rules on rules, by rules, with rules and rules, all over the rules, you know. So obviously, you know, this guy got, you have a good batting team, good bowling team, good fielder team, and you do well, you think you're doing well, and then you bring Virat Kohli, then you lose. Right, you know, okay, that's fine, man. I mean, but still, you know, this is the way to build a team, right? So I am still very much with this. And then, but, you know, so Josh Butler was brought by Carnegie Mellon. They said, yeah, you know what? You attend with brute force, I will regress with brute force. So this is all colors. You know, I couldn't put one color because they not only took two words back, two words forward, they combined all, calculated all kinds of permutations and combinations. The clouds are in the dash, is the clouds are in, cloud are the in the cloud are. Every possible combination of past to make a prediction and concatenated all of that. Similarly, they brute force, Ernie is a brute force on pre-training. I train on many, many more tasks than anyone ever did before. So yeah, I mean, so what will be the trend? My guess is there'll be some researchers that are going to come up with insane embeddings. I mean, I will take a prefix, suffix, part of speech, named entity, or who invented that word, when was it written first time in Twitter. I can embed every possible type of that, and I'll come up with a much better embedding. I'm sure there'll be some research. It'll be fun to read and fun to test. Similarly, there'll be crazy regressions. Now, you know, why only words within a sentence I come up with pattern? I'll figure out a way to embed a sentence before, embed a sentence after, and then come up with all kinds of permutations and combinations at a sentence level to predict. I'm sure there are going to be papers on that. And then maddening attentions, right? You know, six at multi-head, why not? Now I'll do Wikipedia and whatever the YouTube transcription put together and do probably 15 attention heads and then run it for 25 layers, whatever, I'm sure. And pre-training, you know, you come up with very smart ways to pre-train the models further, use GANs to create more data and pre-train on that, I'm sure. And then once in a while, someone comes up with the combining all of these two, put together a model, hopefully. And so the whole idea here is, at least I was quite confused with how to understand why these things are working. But this framework really helped me to put things and have models in place. Okay, you know what, I don't really have to worry about it. This is where I focus. So machines like humans only need those four things. They have to understand the words better. They have to build the ability to predict the trends, and they have to create some rules, and they have to be pre-trained. Once you understand each model in these four dimensions, you figure out a way to see what you really need for this application. More importantly, you figure out a way when to stop. Given the computing power, given the data, huge data, nowadays it's difficult to have a data scientist stop and move on to the next problem, right? That extra 0.01% is so tempting. That's how you do that. But you know, figure out, you know, maybe you're overdoing on one front and you can just stop and move on to simpler things, right? Anyway, that's what I wanted to talk about. Yeah, please go ahead.
Thank you. Thanks, it was a nice talk. I have one query. So you just mentioned before BERT, it was EAP plus pre-trained. Mm. So if any of the business application where you don't know what new terminology in is going to come in your communication with the customer, it's always a new terminology, a new word, right? So for training existing corpus, let's say we can take it from tree bank or some other thing, or which is already available in analytic or something, but that is not going to suffice our purpose. So considering that situation where you every day your for your every transaction, every communication, your customer is using new terminology, so how this model can work with this new terminology, so new how to train that? Yeah,
no, as I mentioned, the word understanding, even this EEAP uses Bloom embeddings, not the word to vec, which can handle out of vocabulary, if that's your question, new terminology. They don't look at word as word only, they look at the prefix. Prefixes are part of the library. I can't run out of, it's very difficult to create a new word with completely new prefix, completely new suffix, completely new word, and that doesn't fit in any of the word categories that I have given. So people have figured out smart ways to come up with a meaningful embedding for the newer words. It's just that word to vec and glove are the oldest versions, but later ones can handle, BERT also has a way to handle. So if you just want to take BERT's word embeddings alone and put it in your EAP, if you think that's simple enough model.
I was talking about that situation where, you know, same word play multiple POS tagging, like noun plus determinator plus verb.
That's
as
okay,
well.
Because you have LSTMs to learn the trending and context. This handles that. Not only word, if it's used in a different context, it learns the context-driven embedding, encoding. So this works even in that situation.
Thank you.
By the way, I saw a few people taking photographs. They have collected my PPT. I think they will give it. They will upload it, right? Yeah, it is there. So you don't really have to, Any other questions? So I am the one they can't upload. So just ask me the questions. Document you'll
Hello.
Get.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you, so how would you approach a problem where we have to do document classification, where documents have a lot of words, maybe on the scale of 10,000, so many sentences. Yeah. So how will you approach this kind of problem?
You know what, these guys, Jeremy of fast.ai actually did it. He first pre-trained using those document vocabulary only, a document text. He pre-trained the model, and then he took a small fraction of it and classified. He got state of the art. So
I was asking about, like, I have to classify multiple novels into their genres, and a novel can have multiple sentences, like 10,000 or 20,000 sentences,
right.
And I don't think the current neural networks will be able to handle those things.
Right. Just check out hierarchical neural networks. So what they do, they start with each word in a sentence and embed that sentence. Now they take these 10,000 sentences and embed each of those sentences and get one final vector. Yeah. And they use that for classification. So the attention is about consolidating all these rules to collapse that entire thing into one vector that respects all the required rules in one go. So check out hierarchical neural nets. They actually solve this problem. Otherwise, what people normally do, take the first few paragraph or first two paragraphs and just solve with that. But if you really want to do it the right way, but if you think about it, a human also doesn't have to read the entire book to classify it. Otherwise, librarian is the wisest man on the earth. Right? He has to read the entire library before he classifies any book, right? You don't do that. So you take the first page, you take the title, you take a few things to make the right guess. So that's also not a bad approach. But if you want to do the entire thing, hierarchical is a good way. Yes.
Okay, one last question we can take. No one, right? So, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.